Honeycomb Earth. The existence of a secret space program has been meticulously and carefully hidden from the American public, and the world at large, for well over 75 years. As you know, if you have read this site or watched our weekly Cosmic Disclosure series on Gaiam TV, I grew up in a world that is so far beyond the limits of most people's imagination that they would immediately write my experiences off as fiction. Most UFO enthusiasts believe the US government acquired working ET spacecraft from the Roswell crash of 1947, almost 70 years ago. Many also believe these craft were successfully reverse-engineered, giving them the ability to effortlessly travel throughout our solar system, and beyond. Even with the crude rocket technology of the 1960s, we were able to send people to the moon, land craft there and drive rovers around on the surface. However, people still hit a severe mental roadblock in imagining that our own reverse-engineered craft were flown to the moon, Mars, and elsewhere, and were used to build bases there out of local materials. Is it possible that a secret space program could have existed without us knowing about it? Absolutely. The Manhattan Project developed the nuclear bomb. It was in operation for 7 years, employed well over 120,000 people, conscripted multiple secret facilities all over the US, and hardly any of its own employees knew what they were working on until the bombs detonated. Remember? Not one person in the Manhattan Project squealed. Not one. Not ever. The penalty for speaking out was terrifying enough to ensure complete compliance. Therefore, it is absolutely possible that an even more advanced program could have been generated, on a much larger scale, and still exist to this day, without any public awareness. Let me assure you. The secret space program SSP is an absolute fact. The bases are out there. They are vast in size, scope, and technology. Our planet is now crumbling in a greater depression because a majority of our wealth has been siphoned off to build this vast, interplanetary infrastructure. Did it really cost NASA $209 billion to launch the space shuttle a few times a year? No. Did the stealth bombers really cost $2 billion apiece to build? No. Did the Pentagon really lose $2.1 trillion, as Donald Rumsfeld announced the day before September 11th? No. I have seen the vast, glittering facilities our money has built with my own eyes. Through the windows and transparent panels of advanced spacecraft. I have landed in those craft and walked in those bases. I have met the people who live and work there. I have seen their faces and spoken to them just like I am speaking to you now. There are millions of other people, originally born here on Earth, who have shared my experiences. Regrettably, hardly any of them have spoken out thus far. Since the threat of doing so can very easily be lethal, and it is nearly impossible to return to Earth once you enter into this world. Many have been a part of this world only to be blank slated. Have screen memories implanted, then returned to live out rather mundane lives? Some of the people who have been robbed of these amazing memories and experiences are some of the strongest skeptics of these topics. We quickly discovered that our own solar system is literally teeming with intelligent civilizations. From many different points of origin. Some of them are extremely benevolent, some are extremely negative and others are just visiting, without really picking a side. The reason so many different types of UFOs have been seen is that there are many, many different civilizations operating in our airspace. With a tremendous diversity of technologies available to them. The SSP has been owned and controlled by a very dark aspect of our planet for some time. An intergenerational cult dating back to at least the Roman Empire. Many have called these secret Earth government syndicates. The Illuminati or Cabal. Their main business is building hyper-advanced technology. And they have gotten quite good at it. As impossible as this may seem, I was told they are now engaging in regular trade with over 900 different intelligent civilizations. If anyone shows up who has something newer and better than the old stuff, they will quickly find a way to acquire it and mass produce it. No matter how unethical or brutal the methods required. Since these secret Earth government syndicates have very negative spiritual beliefs, they ended up allying with the most evil and powerful ET group of all. A confederacy of reptilian humanoid races collectively known as the Draco. It is a sad but accurate fact that the vast majority of those who have joined the SSP are made to take part in brutal and terrifying situations intended to ensure they can never escape, and will never speak out even if they did. I was personally forced into many situations that were deeply traumatic and have forever altered my perspective on reality. Several years ago, an alliance formed within this group to restore peace and freedom to our planet, and release the marvelous technologies that are being held back, but they faced towering obstacles. For many years, Hollywood movies, financed by these same corporate interests, inundated us with film after film of an alien invasion. Any and all such visitors were portrayed as brutal, terrifying villains who must be destroyed at all costs. These films were intended to seed our collective consciousness with fear and terror, a xenophobic hatred of all intelligent civilizations other than our own. The plan was to eventually strike us in a mass alien 9/11, with huge armadas of reverse-engineered craft. In this event they could wipe out any opposing areas or countries they wanted, just level them flat. The phoenix they hoped to rise from these ashes would be a global new world order to fight this so-called alien menace. Of course, they would own and control the whole thing themselves. That was the plan. However, they failed to realize that benevolent ET civilizations held them on a very tight leash, and they would never be permitted to carry through with these plans. A giant, Neptune-sized sphere visited the outer planets of our solar system in the 1980s. It was confronted by our people and asked to leave, which it did willingly. Many more spheres began appearing in the late 1990s into the early 2000s. Then, in approximately the year 2012, another 100-plus spheres arrived. These spheres were of colossal size, with three approximate size categories corresponding to the Moon, Neptune, and Jupiter in circumference. The beings associated with these spheres were very highly advanced. They do not require technology to travel throughout the universe or accomplish any of their goals. Even to the most advanced ETs in contact with our SSP, these new folks are on an entirely different level, and far more advanced. The SSP believed that the benevolent ETs were bound by a prime directive that forced them not to interfere. For many years, that was true. As it turns out, the prime directive was always intended for our own protection, so these negative groups would never actually be able to completely conquer and overthrow our planet. David Wilcock worked since the mid-1990s to spread the word about the greater reality we live in, and along the way came in contact with many high-level insiders with a surprisingly deep knowledge of these classified subjects. After I began disclosing my knowledge to him, and finding countless connections with what other insiders told him, a wild roller coaster of unforeseen events led to me coming forward and revealing my true name and identity to the world. At great personal cost. Only a few months after this was done, the beings within these spheres contacted the SSP and asked for me by name. I had not worked for them for many years, and this was the most profoundly life-altering event I have ever been through since I was first contacted by the Blue Avians a little over 4 years prior. Protocol and paperwork was thrown to the side as I was brought back into a world I had only had seldom, brief contact with since the 1980s. Suddenly, I was being asked to speak on behalf of these beings, the Sphere Alliance, as their delegate. This included addressing the SSP as well as a group of over 40 different intelligent civilizations known as the Super Federation, who have been running 22 different genetic programs on humanity for thousands and thousands of years. Again, I understand that this story seems extremely far-fetched. Let me remind you that I had everything to lose, including a six-figure-a-year salary, and nothing to gain by coming forward. The Gaia TV job does not pay enough to support my family. It has only been through your conscientious donations that I have been able to continue doing this at all. The people in the SSP Alliance had a team member who we are calling Lieutenant Colonel Gonzalez, who had been in contact with the Sphere Alliance for about 4 years. roughly the same length of time as I had been. Gonzalez was the SSB's choice for a delegate. I was an outsider. A has-been, who lacked the training and expertise to be brought into such a role. That was their feeling. As a result, I was ridiculed and harassed when I was brought back into their world. Tensions mounted as they continued to look for flaws and see me as unworthy of the role I was given. I suppose it is human nature to look for character defects in others, particularly if they have been given some position of authority, whether they wanted the job or not. In order to fully understand the background of all my experiences, it is necessary to read previous articles on this site and/or to watch the Cosmic Disclosure series. I had found myself in an awkward position in recent weeks, after I had some meetings with the SSP Alliance Council, that became very heated and personal. They told me, flat out, that they did not want me to be involved in future delegation meetings, and that Gonzalez had proved to be far more adept as a diplomat than I had. Furthermore, I had upset some of the Super Federation members by providing detailed information about some of them at our most recent Gaia TV recording of Cosmic Disclosure, which hasn't even aired yet. It was made pretty clear that they were trying to force me out of the position I was in, and have Gonzalez take my place. Recently, the Sphere Being Alliance indicated that they would not honor the SSP Alliance Council and the Super Federation Council's requests that I be replaced. This led to a meeting with explosive tension where I really lost my cool, as did they. There was yelling, aggression and cursing. I am by no means spiritually superior, and this has been as stressful on me as it has on them. We had a couple of meetings after this first explosive one where things settled down, and we exchanged mutual apologies. Ultimately, we all want the same thing, to free humanity, and our entire solar system, from the rule of these corrupt secret Earth government syndicates, and the highly evil groups that have been controlling them. As a group, the SSP has now been sharing ideas and guidance to help shape my own future, as well as that of humanity as a whole, in a more constructive manner. I am simply the first of many insiders who will be coming forward and revealing the full scope of what has gone on for so long. As I have said before, the NSA held a vast treasure trove of SSP documents for blackmail purposes. Snowden captured all of this data in his epic hack. The encryption was only very recently broken. Once the public is aware and angry enough to hear the truth, such as in the aftermath of a highly upsetting economic collapse, this documentation will be released in a vast data dump. And it will utterly transform reality as we know it in a matter of days. The AD or, after disclosure, society, will be so radically different that every film, every TV show, every blog, every YouTube video, every book, every article, everything from before the event will be as antique and quaint as a black and white silent film with a scratchy, bouncy piano soundtrack. We will realize the awesome scope of deception that worked against us for not hundreds, but literally thousands of years. It will be a time of grief and healing as we are forced to accept the truth of our past, and direct our attention towards co-creating a much bigger and brighter future. In these same meetings, I found out that Gonzalez had attended a couple of Super Federation conferences without my knowledge. He had also attended a newly formed Council of Ancient Earth Breakaway Civilizations. I was aware that advanced civilizations had come and gone from Earth's surface in our distant past. They used their own advanced technology to terraform vast pockets inside the Earth with all the comforts of home. This provided them with a protective barrier against whatever enemies, both natural and extraterrestrial, threatened them on the surface, including cataclysmic natural disasters. In my time at the SSP, I had access to smart glass pads that were similar to an iPad, which revealed some of the civilizations living and warring inside the Earth. Some of them were more human-like and familiar, whereas certain others were reptilian. One particularly nasty race was called the Raptors, and had hideous reptilian features as well as a scrawny plume of feathers running down their backs. This ancient Earth Council, by comparison, was comprised of the more human-like groups. They were aware of some of the other opposing factions, but were not in alliance with them. The human-like groups decided to sort out their differences with one another out of necessity after a rise in conflicts with various other subterranean groups. I was informed that I would be attending meetings with this ancient Earth Council in the near future. This very much excited and intrigued my curiosity. At the same time, these meetings have brought me face to face with highly negative groups, including the Draco White Royal, so I always have a certain sense of dread when facing any new experiences of this type. Not long after I found out I would be meeting this unforeseen new group, I was contacted and given a date and time for when it would happen. I was given no other information about the groups I would meet or what to expect, which I have started to become accustomed to. On the date of the meeting, I expected to travel via a blue orb, as I would normally do for any meeting. This is not how SSP people usually travel by any means. It is a portal system used by the Sphere Alliance that seems to involve the use of a living, conscious being, the blue orb, as the facilitator of a nearly instantaneous journey to wherever I need to go. I made sure I was up and out of bed at the proper time, in the middle of the night. I expected to experience the travel procedure that has now become a normal occurrence. 10 minutes passed and nothing had happened. I walked into my living room. I stood in the living room for a few more minutes and nothing happened. There have been times in the past where meetings were scheduled and they just never occurred, and only later would I find out there had been interference or problems that necessitated their delay. I decided that since I was already awake, and the meeting was not going to happen, I would get on the computer and catch up on emails and Facebook posts. I was standing at the foot of my couch when there was a bright flash of light. I felt a strange static electrical sensation for a moment and then noticed I was not in my house any longer. My eyes were a bit blurry, both from it being very early morning and from the unexpected flash of light. I found myself in a very large and perfectly polished granite room that was round, with a domed ceiling. There were two men in beautiful silk robes and silk fabric sandals standing there. They were standing on either side of an arched doorway. There were similar doorways on all four sides of the room with two men standing sentry. Each of the two men looked slightly different in ethnicity and build. Each man was also wearing a large gold pendant with a different symbol on it. I stood there and looked from door to door. None of the men acknowledged me or acted as if they even noticed that I had just appeared out of nowhere in the room with them. I stood there silently, not knowing whether to call out to them and ask any questions. I once again found myself in a situation with no preparation or intelligence on what to expect or how to engage those that I encountered. Soon afterwards, I heard the sounds of people coming down, what sounded like a corridor in the direction of one of the doors. I then saw five figures emerge from the doorway and head in my direction. They all removed their hoods at the same time as they approached me. I immediately saw Gonzalez walking behind a rather tall and beautiful woman with white hair. She had narrow facial features and large blue eyes. She appeared to be around 30 years of age. Gonzalez had a smirk on his face. I immediately knew it was because the roles were reversed and he had me at a disadvantage. It is very common for soldiers thrown into extreme circumstances to have a buddy-buddy relationship that can involve sarcastic ribbing of each other to help dissipate the tension. In the past, I had been the focal point and he was feeling a bit confused and kept in the dark. Now the tables had turned. I was in the same uncomfortable position Gonzalez had been in before. The group stopped about 20 feet away from me. Gonzalez conversed with them and then approached me alone. The woman and two others turned, and left the way they came. This left one male, with the same basic features as the woman, standing 20 feet away from me. When Gonzalez got close enough, I reached out to shake his hand. He put both his hands up and took a step back. "We have to get you cleansed and changed first. I don't want to have to go through the whole process again." He then turned and started walking towards the person standing close by, and motioned for me to follow. I asked him what was going on. He said they are very serious about their cleansing ceremonies prior to entering the womb of Isis. I tried not to make a strange face and just followed him. We walked towards the doorway that he emerged from. As we entered, I could see there was a symbol etched over the archway with laser-like precision. This symbol appeared over all of the doorways in the area we spent our time in. It was two intersecting circles inside an oval. The door led to a long, smooth corridor that was also carved out of the same granite-like rock. I could hear the echoing sound of water running over rocks while in the tunnel-like corridor. When we had reached what appeared to be the halfway point, there was a door to the left that led into a brightly lit room where the sound of water was coming from. This door had an 8-pointed star on each side. There was a gold star on the left side and a red one on the right. The gold star was slightly larger and positioned a bit higher than the red star. The man that was walking behind us stopped at the door and turned his back to it. We entered in and I saw a beautiful waterfall that was flowing through a port-like opening in the ceiling. There were off-white stalactites hanging from the opening, and what looked like milk-white water pouring down onto a statue of a goddess. The water then ran off the statue and drained into a pool that the statue was standing in. The goddess statue had a visible buildup of mineral deposits. The surrounding pool had an opening that created another small waterfall, which drained into a wider pool that was closer to the floor. After I had taken in the view of the water feature, I looked over at Gonzalez. He told me to remove all of my clothing and place it next to his, on a stone pedestal that rose about 3 feet out of the polished stone floor. I noticed other pedestals with folded up garments of different colors sitting on top of them. There were also what looked like thin gold crowns or tiaras laying on top of these garments. I looked at him and told him I had no idea what was going on. I would really appreciate an explanation, right away, as to why I was being asked to disrobe. I also wanted to know what other strange requests I might receive. Gonzalez seemed to be enjoying himself a little too much at my expense, and that didn't improve my mood. He then smiled and told me to relax. He stated that these subterranean groups are very much into Venus and goddess worship, and that they reference their sanctuaries as being the womb of the earth. It is holy ground, and we have to respect their cultural and spiritual practices. I was already shivering a little bit from wearing the black exercise shorts and blue t-shirt in the already cool environment. Gonzalez saw the hesitation on my face. He told me not to be so shy. He said he would turn around, but that he had to instruct me in the cleansing process. He told me that if I was uncomfortable with him seeing me naked, he would leave the room and send in the other person who watched and guided him through the process. I shook my head and took off my clothes, folded and placed them on the pedestal. I was standing there totally humiliated. Gonzalez was chuckling and trying not to look directly at me. Right when I thought it couldn't get any worse, the woman walked in with a folded robe, sandals, and towels in her hands. I exhaled in displeasure and glared at Gonzalez, who was still enjoying my predicament way too much. He took a step back so the woman could approach me. She smiled and handed me the garment and towels. She bowed her head, turned and bowed her head to Gonzalez, and then left the room. After she had left the room, Gonzalez broke out laughing. He walked over, took the items from me and set them down. He made a joke about how cold it was in the room. He then began guiding me through the bathing and cleansing process. The water was ice cold. After I had dried and placed the robe and sandals on the pedestal, he told me that I needed to remain quiet and respectful during this first visit and just observe. He said that these groups have recently formed this council out of necessity. Some of them have a very long and complicated history with each other. He also told me that these groups had an even more complicated history with surface civilizations, going back over many thousands of years. I was informed that they do not have the most positive view of us. He further stated that these groups often come across as elitist and prejudiced against the surface population, and that I needed to keep my opinions on the matter to myself. I was trying not to let my ego be a factor in the equation. Nonetheless, I was feeling a little frazzled after the public bath, being laughed at and then having Gonzalez worry I was going to speak out of turn, as I did at a previous meeting, when there was a veiled threat against my family. This was in the Committee of 200 meeting that took place at the castle, detailed in earlier posts on this site. I know Gonzalez meant no harm and this was a part of his personality, but it was still a little soon. Some wounds were still fresh from the previous couple of meetings I had with the SSP Alliance Council, when things had gotten pretty heated. I took a deep breath and cleared my mind of the prior emotional baggage, so that it would not be detected by our current hosts, who had greater intuitive abilities than any average human like us. I told Gonzalez I understood, and was ready if he didn't have anything else to add. He then picked up on how frazzled I had been, and looked a bit concerned. He looked at me, tilted his head and started to say something. Right then, the woman and three men walked a few paces into the room. They bowed their heads and looked at us. Gonzalez then turned and walked towards them, motioning once again for me to follow him. A few feet before we reached the others, they turned and walked out the door ahead of us. They turned left, and then continued on down the corridor. The corridor then began to angle down and curve to the right, where it then widened into a rectangular room with tall ceiling. A larger door was directly ahead. I then wondered to myself where all of the light was coming from. The corridor and rooms were well lit, but I had not seen any source for the lighting. We stopped in the room and no one was speaking. I was looking around for the light source when the woman turned and spoke to me. Her voice had an accent I have never heard before. In English, she said the visible light is created by frequency. I was surprised and looked at her, but before I could say anything in response, another woman walked through the large door. She was wearing the same white silk robe, and was wearing the hood over the top of her head. She looked at each of us, making eye contact with us one by one. Then she turned and went back out through the doorway without saying a word. Somehow I knew immediately to put my hood on, as did everyone else. We walked through the door and then down a curved stone staircase, one level down. The stairs angled to the left. At the bottom, there was another doorway with the same symbol over the arch. We began to file through the door and into the room, two by two. There were people in the same robe sitting around an oval table. Other people were standing and sitting on stone benches, and they also wore the same robes. I then began to notice that every person was wearing a pendant. The pendants were often different in appearance, and had various symbols on them. I realized that these were the symbols of their groups. I noticed a few of them touching and tapping their pendants. They would then look down at what could only be described as holograms. These pendants were not just a jewelry that represented their civilization or group. They were also a technology. As Gonzalez and I were being shown our seat at the front of the room, I got a good look at the stone table. It had a large, golden 8-pointed star in the center, with a smaller 8-pointed red gem star to the bottom right of the gold star, from our perspective. The people who had guided us to this point seemed to be the hosts of the meeting. They were all wearing pendants that appeared to feature a stylized image of Saturn, including the rings. Each of these pendants had a single jewel that was placed at a different location on the surface of the planet. Gonzalez later told me that the location of and type of gem represented where their particular region was located under the Earth. One of the people with the Saturn pendants that had a rose-colored gem at the bottom stood up from the table. He introduced Gonzalez and myself, as well as the names, designations, and group names of those around the table and in the room. As each person was introduced, they removed their hood. Gonzalez has asked that I withhold these names, designations, and group names for a few reasons. The main reason is that he wanted to maintain their trust. He didn't want a repeat of upsetting anyone, as happened recently when I went into detail about the types of non-terrestrials that attend the Super Federation conference. This caused some of these Super Federation members to request that Gonzalez take my place at future meetings, a request that was denied. I was never told not to share this information, but it was thrown in my face later during a meeting with the SSP Alliance Council as one of the reasons they wanted Gonzalez to be the delegate and not me. I have never had a problem admitting that Gonzalez is more of a diplomat and a better public speaker than I am. That decision, however, was not up to the SSP Alliance Council, Gonzalez, or myself, unless I had turned down the invitation in the beginning. I will share the symbols that were on the pendants of those in attendance at this meeting. When I got back home, I drew all of the symbols on a piece of paper and emailed it to my web administrator, who is also pretty good at rendering graphics. From that sheet of paper, he created or found the images in this report, which are an excellent representation of what we saw on the pendants of these various subterranean groups. These different people were obviously human, but they appeared ethnically different than anyone you would see on the surface. There were people with stocky builds, African features and bronze skin. There were also people who appeared Asian and Indian, with different skin tones, including a very pale blue, and body types not normally associated with those ethnic groups on the surface. There was a group that appeared very Mediterranean. There was a group that looked very much like a normal Caucasian from the Earth's surface. There were also the tall, thin and pale people with white, blonde, black and brown hair that were hosting this event. The Mayan ancient breakaway civilization I have described in previous reports was not present at this meeting. Within the group that wore the Saturn pendants, there were also people that looked similar, yet had slightly different body types. In addition to the Saturn symbols, there was also a silver star, a gold curved swastika, though this was not a Nazi breakaway group, an Omega symbol with an 8-pointed gold star in the center, and a symbol that looked like an hourglass. This may have been a stylized representation of the constellation of Orion. I must admit that seeing that swastika symbol, along with some of their other terms and symbol sets, was unsettling enough that I almost buried this entire report. I am by no means anti-Semitic, and neither were any of these groups, though they seemed to view all of us on the surface with varying degrees of disdain. When I mentioned the swastika to David Wilcock, he shared with me that the Germans co-opted the symbol after seeing it featured in a mind-blowing lecture by Gurdjieff in the early 20th century. Gurdjieff revealed the astonishing prevalence of this same symbol from cultures all over the earth, the Hindus, the Hopis, the Japanese, the Eskimos, the Greeks, the Romans, you name it. On every continent except Antarctica. This was one of the main symbols that their gods gave them to represent themselves. Gurdjieff saw it as obvious proof of an advanced, worldwide intelligent civilization, which attracted the Germans to it. Gurdjieff was likely drawing off of a highly contentious Yale University study from 1898 that was later banned as the Nazis rose to power. Widespread attempts were made to sanitize the study from the academic record, though it still survives. The link to this study is enclosed in this written article. The article link is located in the description. After the person at the table had made the introductions, I realized that 7 different groups were being represented, even though 3 of them were obviously allied or genetically related. Each group was made up of 3 representatives. The room we were in was repeatedly referred to as the womb of Isis. I found out later that this was a temple complex reserved for spiritual and political events. Most of the groups were made up of 1 or 2 women, except the group with the 8-pointed star symbol inside the Greek Omega character, which was made up entirely of men. The obvious leader of this group made reference to the Prince of Venus, the Morning Star and the Bearer of Light several times. This was deeply unsettling to me because of obvious association of Lucifer with these terms. I picked up on the energy of the other groups, and they all seemed very uncomfortable with this particular group, which was not surprising. One of the other groups has a well-known and powerful fleet of craft that the secret space programs have developed a healthy respect for, and I recognized them and their symbol immediately. The discussions between these groups then began. They were asked by the person doing the introductions to speak English for their guests, but this didn't last long. They would speak English and then switch over to some other language. Gonzalez later told me this was a pre-Akkadian tongue that has long since died out on the surface of the planet. Then they would switch back over to English yet again. There were also exchanges in a couple of other long-gone languages. Telepathic communication took place between individuals in the room as well. It was naturally all very confusing and hard for me to follow. I was able to make out that they were discussing attacks that had occurred against various subterranean cities, and the casualties that occurred. They also discussed the betrayals they had suffered from certain secret societies and groups on the surface that they previously thought they had under their control. I was able to determine that their enemies on the surface now had technology that allowed them to locate their cities and bypass their defenses. The people on the surface had developed exotic weapons that could penetrate to the greatest depths and do tremendous damage. This meant that all bets were off. These surface groups had now become their violent and ruthless enemies. They felt vulnerable and threatened, and needed to rely upon one another for protection. They also spoke of the surface people building more and more of their own cities under the surface, and polluting the very delicate subterranean ecosystem in the process. They also were having to deal with recent skirmishes with a variety of very nasty non-human subterranean groups. This was causing them a great deal of concern. It became clear that all of these mounting pressures had caused them to form an alliance with one another, something that would have hitherto seemed almost impossible to fathom. This discussion went on for about 2 hours, and we were only able to follow a small amount of what was said. Then, the leader of the Omega-8-pointed star group invited Gonzalez to speak. Gonzalez later told me that this person was not showing the proper respect to his hosts by doing so. Gonzalez knew the protocols between these groups, and sought to follow them as carefully as possible. Gonzalez looked to the woman wearing the Saturn pendant with the rose-colored jewel, and she gave him the nod to proceed. He then stood and spoke from where he was sitting right next to me. I was not in a position to look up at him when he spoke, so I looked around the room while he was talking. Gonzalez addressed each group by name, and thanked them for their invitation to participate as a representative of the Alliance. He expressed his appreciation to the group that was hosting this council meeting. He further stated that it was an honor to receive and host their small delegation, which had traveled to one of the SSP Alliance outposts in the Kuiper Belt at great personal risk in the weeks prior. Gonzalez said that despite some significant differences in points of view, and the former alliances that had been in direct conflict with what we were all now hoping to achieve, he was here to relay the hopes of the SSP Alliance Council that an understanding could be reached between all parties. This would include changes in how these groups engaged the governments and civilians that they were in contact with on the surface of the planet. He paused, and I could see he was choosing his words carefully. He was trying his best not to broadcast his thoughts and emotions to the highly perceptive audience. He then looked up and delivered what seemed like a loosely prepared speech that was short, and yet got right to the point. He addressed the complicated history that these and other ancient human breakaway groups have had with surface civilizations, going back over tens of thousands of years. He also addressed each group in the room, openly engaging them on their past and current deceptions with governments, militaries, and civilians. He ended his speech on the note that we are entering a new era that should involve open cooperation and honesty. I could feel the sudden rise of tension and mixed emotions and energy in the room as he said this. Gonzalez bowed his head and sat back down beside me, while keeping his gaze towards the delegation around the table. They began to speak among themselves in a couple of different languages. At times they spoke past each other, or talked over each other. They were often motioning back at Gonzalez and me in the process. They were speaking calmly, but it was obvious that they were not pleased with at least some of what Gonzalez had just communicated. We then received a very condescending lecture from each of them about how we have no right to judge them with our limited understanding and knowledge. They each described their perceptions of those of us on the surface as uncivilized barbarians who are diseased and genetically impure. They said they were the only ones who had preserved the various original Earth human bloodlines. Wave after wave of refugees from nearby planets had since co-mingled their genetics with the original humans of this planet, and had taken over the surface world like a plague. They stated that in the nearly 20 million years since the original human bloodlines had arisen on Earth, there had been 4 major cataclysms that had either changed the Earth's axis, rotation, or orbital path around the Sun. Each time one of these events occurred, the elite or priest caste kept their genetic line pure through isolating themselves beneath the ground. These small groups survived while their surface counterpart civilizations perished. over oceans of time and smaller destructive events on the surface, which were still obviously catastrophic, nearly all signs of their former civilizations were erased from the memories of the survivors. Only myths and legends of advanced gods remained. They stated that they would emerge from time to time to kick-start the civilization of the survivors who were the most closely related to them in terms of their genetics. They claimed that these surviving races assumed they were the gods of their own ancient legends. It was decided that they would allow those they were assisting to believe they were gods, in order to keep their subterranean civilization secret and secure. They also stated that there were other planets in our solar system that were inhabited during this time period that were also suffering from extreme cataclysms. To add to this incredible story, they stated that more and more advanced groups began to arrive from outside our solar system during and after these cataclysmic events. These new groups began to take advantage of the situation, such as to farm and manipulate the genetics of the natives of this solar system. They claimed that the Earth became the destination of the refugees from these other inhabited planets. Advanced ETs relocated these refugees here in several waves as cataclysms occurred on their home planets. The refugee races were genetically similar to the original humans of Earth, but were much more aggressive. It turned out that many of these refugees were from a very advanced civilization that had destroyed itself through war and high technology. The use of some of these weapons not only caused destruction on an interplanetary scale, but generated a unique energy signature. This energy signature attracted the attention of the ET groups that were now entering our solar system en masse, and who then started up a genetic farming experiment. The subterranean groups claimed that there had been an ancient civilization that had protected this region of the galaxy for literally billions of years. They were referred to as the Guardians, and the secret space program referred to them as the Ancient Builder Race. This was covered in previous episodes of Cosmic Disclosure and in writings on this site. This Guardian race was extremely advanced. There were no other ET groups who would even think of violating their region of space. The Guardians had long since disappeared from our frequency. They had created a protective field or technology within their domain that kept it safe for a vast amount of time after they had physically disappeared. According to those telling this story, the residents of the other inhabited planets in our solar system unknowingly disrupted this protective technology put in place by the Guardians. When they used their advanced weapons in aggression against other races, this caused a massively destructive chain of events to occur. This had the unfortunate consequence of disabling the protective field that had been in place, ensuring their protection and survival. When the field went down, this sent out a signal to the rest of the cosmos like a beacon. The survivors of those inhabited worlds within our solar system relocated to the Earth. They were extremely aggressive, and began to reproduce and interbreed with the original humans that were on the Earth's surface. It was not long before the subterranean groups saw this new mixed race as a threat to their existence. This new mixed race is the current surface population of the Earth today. Now more than ever, they knew they had to keep their civilization secret to preserve their genetic integrity, and the security of hundreds of their ancient and cherished subterranean temples and cities. They had the advanced technologies to both hide and defend themselves from these ET groups. They began to play a long-term strategic game against them, using the surface race that the ETs were so interested in as pawns. They continued to appear to certain distant genetic relatives on the surface as gods and ascended teachers, to help them develop their civilizations and themselves spiritually. This was done in the hopes that they might be able to overcome the aggressive part of their genetic programming. This effort has continued right up until the present time. They decided to start presenting themselves as ETs from other star systems when the surface population became more technologically sophisticated. They say that we'll continue to do this to keep the people they make contact with looking to the stars, instead of beneath their feet. They further stated that our recent disclosure about their activities will be counteracted against with contradictory information and communications that they will make to their surface contacts. The planted disinformation will state that there are indeed imposters, but they are in contact with the real ET group while the other contactees are only communicating with tricksters. To be perfectly clear, This is not to imply that all contactees fall under this category. The number, however, is quite vast. In part 2 I will describe the area I was shown where hundreds of their people were reclined and reaching out to people on the surface with their minds. They had a series of additional programs where they were making physical contact with civilians on the surface in their craft. They said they will continue this practice until certain conditions have been met. One of these conditions is that the surface population must remove the current control system, which is run by these same ET groups they have been working against. Secondly, they will also need to see that the surface population has overcome its barbaric, uncivilized behavior and genetic programming. They stated that they are not optimistic that we will be able to accomplish this, even with the continued energetic changes or return and assistance of the Guardians. This was quite surprising to hear, as they were obviously referring to the Sphere Alliance as the Guardians. David Wilcock told me the Law of One series indicated that their civilization had evolved into a highly advanced state from their origins on our planet Venus, 1.2 billion years ago. Since I have been personally asked by the Sphere Alliance to read the Law of One, this is a very interesting correlation. David said it is a game changer that ties many loose ends of the story together. The ancient builder race left behind a vast collection of pyramids, obelisks and other such structures throughout our solar system, often made out of a glass-like alloy of transparent aluminum. A variety of these artifacts still exist within vast cavities below the Earth's surface. These subterranean groups are under the impression that after a full disclosure event and the removal of the manipulative ETS from our solar system, it will still take several generations for us to heal and evolve as a civilization. Only then will we be able to have open contact with their civilizations as equals. They were not exactly thrilled about forming this new council, or reaching out to the SSP Alliance Council to request contact with the newly returned Guardians. Apparently the Guardians were not going to contact them on their own. If they wanted any access at all, they had to work with us as a team. They flatly stated that they were doing this under duress. Their alliance was forced into existence by the vast array of problems they were having. This included the lethal resistance they were encountering from various subterranean ET refugees and ancient pre-human Earth races. Their problems were further compounded by the recent betrayals they had suffered from certain secret societies and kingships of the surface population. They stated they were well aware that various members of the SSP Alliance had been involved in crimes against humanity before they broke away, to resist the activities of various ET and mixed surface race groups. They were reserving judgment of us, and of our point of view, just as we should reserve judgment of them and their point of view. This was obviously a stalemate topic that could go no further. Gonzalez stood up and quickly bowed his head to each of the people who were around the table and had been speaking. He sat back down, leaned over, and whispered, "That went well, didn't it?" I didn't reply, because I was sitting there with all of this information that I had just heard flowing through my head. I was trying to tie it in with the established knowledge I had gained from the smart glass pads and the meetings with various other groups. Much of this was new, or at least far more detailed than anything I had heard before. I was also wondering how accurate it all was, since it was coming from a group that admittedly has been deceiving the surface population of Earth for many thousands of years. These are indeed times for each of us to discern new information on a deeper level than our established belief systems. It is clearly going to take more than talk and promises for us to be able to trust people who have admitted to deceiving us, and who have only formed an alliance out of the fear of their own annihilation. I was deep in thought when I heard some voices that now sounded a mile away. Everyone around stood up and placed their hoods back on their heads, so I quickly did the same. Each of the seven groups uttered a very short statement in this pre-Akkadian language. They then began to line up at the only doorway into the room, this womb of Isis. No one was talking, and all you could hear was the shuffling of feet and robes as they waited for the hosts to dismiss everyone from the room. After a few moments, everyone began slowly moving through the door. I was still going over all of the information I had just heard in my head. We all worked our way back the way we came, through the series of winding stairs, twists and curves. We returned to where we had originally found ourselves in the main corridor. Now we were walking up a slight incline towards the room with the ceremonial water feature. This would then lead us directly back to the very large domed room I had originally arrived in. I mentally prepared myself to have to go back into the cleansing room and face the possibility of another public nudity scenario, this time with a much larger audience. Then I noticed the group ahead of us passed right by the door to this room, and headed directly into another large domed room. Just as I was feeling a modicum of relief, I felt a tap to my left arm by Gonzalez. I glanced back to see him now stopped a couple paces behind me. He was standing there along with two of the striking women from the host group. He was looking past me at the rest of the group, while holding his finger to his lips. He was clearly indicating that he wanted me to keep silent. I looked back and could see bright flashes of light coming from the large domed room the rest of the group had moved into. I turned and moved to stand next to Gonzalez. He was quietly standing there at ease, with one hand holding his wrist. I had already noticed that one of the women kept looking over at me from time to time. Now I felt that she had something to say. As soon as the light stopped flashing at the end of the hall, the woman who had greeted me on arrival and delivered the garments in the cleansing room stepped forward. She said, "Please come with me. I have a personal request. I was told that the delegation was visiting each of their local domains and some of them would be back for another purification or cleansing ceremony and I would imagine to retrieve their clothes." Gonzalez was looking at me with a confused expression on his face. Since she had addressed me directly, I told her I would be happy to hear her request. She smiled, and said, "Walk with me." She began to walk towards the large room that I had arrived in. Gonzalez and the other woman walked together behind us, by about 5 paces. I expected an explanation, or to hear the request, but instead we began to walk for some time in silence. We walked through the large domed room at the end of the corridor, went straight across the room and traveled on through the door on the other side. The room was now empty. No one was standing sentry at the 4 doors. We continued down another corridor that had more doors than the previous one. I forgot all about counting paces and doors, or any other intelligence gathering methods we were supposed to do in a new facility per standard operating procedure. SOP. I could tell she had something serious to ask me. All sorts of things were going through my head. I was definitely nervous about whatever this might be leading up to. This took my mind off of all of the new data I had been trying to process a few minutes earlier. Each of the rooms in this corridor had some sort of energy field or hard light covering them that prevented me from seeing inside of them. We finally stopped at one of the doors after a few turns in the corridor. She tapped her pendant, and the doorway went translucent. Then I could see inside the room. It appeared to be some sort of lounge or private quarters from what I could tell from the doorway. She looked at Gonzalez and his escort, and said, "Please remain here." Then she walked inside, turned and looked at me. I looked over at Gonzalez, who looked even more confused. I then walked inside the room with her. She tapped her pendant and the energy barrier reappeared over the doorway. Being an introvert and a bit shy around women I do not know well, I began to feel nervous and a bit self-conscious. She then began to telepathically interface with me. She asked me to relax. She wanted to know if I would share a childhood experience with her. She went on to communicate that there was a very special place to her people that has been off limits to them for many hundreds of years. She communicated that a non-human subterranean group had taken possession of this place. They are an ancient species that are indigenous to the earth, which she called the Dalazig, which means feathered serpents. She sent me a mental image of one of them. Even though I have never interacted with one, I recognized them from a database I had viewed on a smart glass pad as the raptors. As I said before, these are some of the most tenacious and dangerous subterranean groups we are faced with. To us, they appear hideous looking. They are carnivorous, highly aggressive, and will attack and consume humans on sight. She showed me an image of one of their ruling caste. This race has plumes of feathers running down the back of their heads and necks, almost like the crest of a bird. I had read how they move in a jerky fashion, much like birds. Now, her mental image gave me a much clearer vision of how they actually appear and move. It was definitely unsettling. She communicated that this race has had a tenuous alliance with some of the factions of the surface human civilization. These beings have allowed this surface group to venture down into their domain. However, this race required a gift of human flesh, just as in the time before the Spanish conquered the land above. These human secret societies from the surface had no moral compunction against providing them with such gifts. I had heard all of this before. Although it was horrible, I was not shocked. Other groups have similar arrangements. She finally got to the part that concerned me in my own immediate present. She was well aware that when I was an adolescent, I was taken to a deep crystal cavern where I was told the crystals were alive. I was with a group of other children at the time. We were told not to touch the crystals, because it would harm them or they could harm us. We were asked to try to telepathically interface with the crystals. I was one of many who had been able to successfully interface with these crystalline life forms. David Wilcock shared that this is another intriguing correspondence with the Law of One information. The series tells us that when the Earth was first prepped for human life, hyper-advanced crystals were placed inside the Earth that had their own form of sentience. The Law of One said these crystals were intended to work almost like what we would now think of as internet servers. They answer the spiritual calls people make as they begin awakening. The crystals are programmed to encourage people to be more loving and to meditate. These messages will appear in a variety of forms, including dreams, synchronicities and visions. If these directions are then followed, the crystals signal more advanced benevolent groups to move in and provide far more nuanced and detailed spiritual instructions. I had never before encountered this information when David told me this. It was one of dozens of fascinating correlations that arose once we began speaking with each other. I communicated back that I remembered the experience. I sent her a mental image of the cavern as well as the strange auroras of energy I saw around the crystals. She closed her eyes and smiled. A large tear rolled down her thin cheek. She asked if I would share my complete memory of that experience with her.
Hi, Receiving Love speaking here. As requested by Corey Good, I have reposted only a portion of this article. Actually, I've posted a little more than half of it, it is a long one, and I have left you at an important cliffhanger. The rest of this intel update is fascinating, it involves a mind meld with this priestess, and this can be read on his website, which, I have linked directly to the whole article in the description box below. It just gets deeper from here, so please visit Corey Good's website, spherebeingalliance.com.